Good morning, good morning. Good morning and welcome to Transformation Community Church. This is a day that the Lord hath made and we will rejoice and be glad in it. My name is Jason Flowers and I am the pastor here at Transformation Community Church. And again, I just thank you all for joining us here on this Sunday morning. I know you have many places to worship, but I'm just so thankful and grateful that you chose us. Our vision here is to transform the lives of people through the word of God and the love of Christ everywhere. Amen. So what we've been doing here has been on this topic on relationships. And the title of our series has been Relationships, It's a Matter of the Heart. And this has been a phenomenal series. So if you missed part one, we talked about relationships. You can't live without them. Week two, we talked about a relationship for life. And that was talking about a relationship with God and how important it is to have a relationship with God. And then last week, we talked about time to part ways. And that's anytime you're in a toxic relationship, how to part ways with that toxic relationship. So we're excited about that series that we're in. And this is part four of the series. I'll give you the name of the title here here shortly, but I wanted to bring you up to date. So if you missed any of those weeks, you can feel free to go back. You can go back and watch them on our social media platforms, which is Facebook. So you can follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram, and that is at TCC Arizona. So if you missed anything, just follow us at TCC Arizona. We're on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. And then also we have a tremendous and awesome website, and that is transformationaz.com. Transformationaz.com. You can go to that website, learn more about us here at Transformation Community Church. And there's also a tab where you can see all of our sermons there at our website, transformationaz.com. So another announcement real quick is, man, I'm so excited you all have been following Lady Renee on Wednesdays. On Wednesdays, we have Winning Women Wednesdays with Lady Renee. And again, you can follow her on YouTube and on Facebook and on Instagram. She gives you an inspiring word every Wednesday that gets you through the week. And then I'm just so excited again that you found time to come see me on Fridays. It was Friday, 2-Minute Drill with Pastor Flowers. And again, just give you a word that's going to get you through your weekend. Keep you focused on God throughout your weekend. Amen. Amen. So again, that's Friday 2-Minute Drill with Pastor Flowers. You can see that on YouTube, Facebook, and on Instagram. Amen. So just another thing that we're doing here in the selection, we are a church that loves to serve. We are a church that gets out into the community and we love to serve. What we're doing here now is connected with the agency, Homeless Youth Connection. Homeless Youth Connection. And what that agency does, it reaches out to young kids that are homeless. And you would be amazed how many young children are homeless in the time and age that we live in. And what we're doing now is we're putting together care kits that we're going to deliver to those children so that they can have all the necessities that they need. Although they're maybe lacking in homes, we just don't want them to lack in the necessities that they need, daily hygiene products that they need to get through their day. So if you feel compelled in your heart to make a donation to us, there'll be ways that you can do that towards the end of the service. I'll let you know how you connect with us to donate for that project. And then the other thing that we do, we started our own food pantry. We have our own food pantry. Glory to God. Glory to God. We started our own food pantry. This past Saturday, we were out in the community delivering boxes of food to those who are homeless, to those who are needy, to those who are hungry. And hey, just something came upon us about a week or two ago to say, we're just going to start our own food pantry. So we have a storage house here. It says in the Bible that you should have your storage house should be full. So in times of when there's desolation going on or when there's not enough going on, that we have things here. So if you know anyone that needs food, that needs perishable goods, non-perishable goods, we have our own food pantry here, and we'd be more than happy to partner with them and make sure that they have food not only for today but throughout the week. Amen. 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 So we have a great leadership team here. We have Pastor Art that's here. We have Sister Rachel that's here. We have Brother Josh that's here. We have Elder Kimberly that's here. And of course, Lady Renee is here. We have some others that are not present with us here physically, but they are watching online. We have an outstanding leadership team here, and all we want to do is serve you. Amen. Amen. So let's get into our sermon for today. Before we do that, let us pray. If you could just bow your heads in prayer. Dear Father, we just thank you for this day, our daily bread. We just thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. And we thank you for things being as well as they are. Dear Father, in the name of Jesus and the power of your blood, we ask that you just continue to be with us, lead and guide us in the path you would have us to go. In the name of Jesus and the power of your blood, we ask that you make the devil our footstool, that no weapon formed against us should prosper. Dear Father, that you would place in all of our hearts that we are the head and not the tail, that we are above only and not beneath. Dear Father, we are the borrower, we are the lender and not the borrower. In the name of Jesus and the power of your blood, I ask that you hide me behind the cross, and that the word that we go forth will be edifying to your people. Dear Father, that they will hear and see more of you and less of me. In the name of Jesus and the power of your blood, we ask this all in your name. Amen. Amen. So again, we are on relationships. This is an awesome relationship. This is the last series, the last part of the series. And we're going to talk about marriages today. Marriages today. So the title of the sermon today is Marriage, Make It Last Forever. Marriage, Make It Last Forever. Yeah. And so our scripture is going to come from Genesis 2, and I'll be reading 18 through 25. Again, it's Genesis 2, 18 through 25. So open your Bibles. That's where I'll be. Let's go to the word. And the Bible says, "The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now, the Lord God had formed out of the ground all of the wild animals and all of the birds in the sky. He brought them to a man to see what he could name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, to the birds and all the sky and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That is why a man leaves his father and mother, and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame." Amen. Amen. So marriage, brothers and sisters, marriage, I mean, that is sacred to the Lord. Marriage is sacred to the Lord. And I'm here to tell you that the devil is out to devour marriages. The devil is, he doesn't want to see people get married. And when you are married, he don't want people to stay married, because he knows that he's out to seek, devour, and destroy. And that is families. Marriage is a basic, and that is needed in families. Amen. Amen. So that's what the devil's out to do. So I want you to know in advance that the devil's not on your side. Amen. So he's against marriage because he's against family. So marriage is a divine, distinctive, designated, directed, and enduring institution instituted by Almighty God and given to man in state of innocence and happiness. The marriage vow is very, very, very serious promise, with the exception of the pledge of faithfulness. So outside of being faithful to the Lord, marriage comes second. Marriage is not of human origin, and it's not a disposable relationship, meaning that you just can't cast it aside whenever you get good and ready. Amen. Amen. So marriage is instituted by God as a covenant relationship. So your covenants is an agreement. So if you think of a covenant, covenant is just a higher level of an agreement. So you got your basic agreements, like I'm going to shake your hand and we're going to shake on this. That's an agreement to a certain extent. But when you have a covenant, that covenant is with the Lord. So that is a higher level of a covenant. So it's a covenant relationship between a man and a woman. Amen. Amen. So we're going to dig deep into marriages. We're going to dig deep into what a healthy marriage looks like. We're going to dig deep into marriages. Amen. Amen. You ready? Amen. Let's go. So the very first thing we're going to look at is where it says leave and cleave. I like that one. Leave and cleave. So in Genesis 2 and 24, it says, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother. I want you all to hear that. Father and mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Amen. Amen. So here's what I got for y'all. Leave and cleave means that it says father and mother. So I know sometimes daughters are really close to their fathers, but you got to leave that alone. Sometimes sons are really close to their mothers, but you got to leave that alone. Amen. So if you're quote unquote mama's boy, you can't be mama's boy anymore. You got to be your wife's boy. Quote, if you are daddy's girl, you can't be daddy's girl no more. You got to be your husband's girl. Amen. Come on now. Help me. Come on, Jesus. Y'all know I'm telling the truth. You got it. Says leave and cleave your mother and father. Amen. Amen. So that being said, you know, you shouldn't have a third party or third party or person should have influence on your marriage. No third party or person should have influence on your marriage. So you got a best friend that's always in your ear trying to tell you this or tell you that. You gotta put them aside. You gotta set them aside because they have no business in your marriage. Amen. Amen. Even if it's your mother or your father. Sometimes, you know, we go to our parents. Some people call their parents their best friend. Sometimes you go to your parents and share things. You can't share everything that's in your marriage with your parents because you are their child. And at the very end of the day, they're going to look out for you. They're going to protect you. They're going to be on your side. They only going to hear your side of the story and not the other side of the story. Hey, you got to don't take everything to your parents. It's good to have a good relationship, close relationship with your parents, but they don't need to know everything that's going on in your marriage. Amen. Amen. So you got to leave that stuff out. So no third party or person should have an influence in your marriage. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter who it is. It doesn't matter where it is. It has no influence in your marriage. Amen. Amen. So the husband has to rely on the wife. It says they shall be one flesh. You got to rely on husbands. You got to rely on your wife. And wife, you got to rely on your husbands because you're one flesh. You're no longer two separate people. So we're talking about a relationship here that is a covenant that is laid out by God. You have to become one flesh. There's no longer the husband doing his thing or the wife doing her thing. You got to do this thing together because I'm here to tell you that the devil is against marriage. The devil, as soon as you say I do, the devil is out to get you. Help me somebody. Come on now. And then so you got the husband and you got the wife. So you got these two different entities coming together. They were raised in different environments, raised by different parents. Of course, you have some similarities that brought you together, but at the very end of the day, we all are products of our environment, and our environments are not the same. It doesn't matter. I have brothers and sisters. We grew up in the same house, but my environment was not the same as their environment. What I saw out of my lens is not the same thing they saw out of their lens. We are two different people, although we were raised in the same household. So you're bringing together two different entities into one. So with that, you can't do it by yourself. That's something you just can't do by yourself. Our flesh is not that strong. So that's why you have to have God in your relationship. That's why you got to have God in your relationship. It talks about this three strands. So there's your strand as a wife, and there's a strand as a husband. But there's that third strand called Jesus Christ that you got to have in that relationship if you want that thing to succeed. If you want that thing to make it, you got to have Jesus. The divorce rate is high. The divorce rate is over 50%. But I'm here to tell you, those that stay together, they have Jesus in their relationship. So Jesus has to be that third strand that binds it all together, that keeps it all together. I know I'm preaching to some right now that's going through a troubled marriage or someone that's about to get married. They're trying to understand how does this thing work. I'm here to tell you, it's all about putting Jesus Christ as that third strand that is your glue to everything that happens. Amen. Amen. So you both got to rely on God. So God gives specific directions and regulations for the relationship of a marriage. He gives specific. It's very specific. It's in the Bible. It's very specific. So he tells you, what's the role of the wife in this relationship? the role of the wife. And I'm going to take you to Ephesians 5, 22 through 24. Ephesians 5, 22 through 24. And it says, wives, talking about wives. That means husbands, you still need to listen, but this is right for the wives. It said, wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do the Lord. Now, it didn't say you got to be submissive or you're less than. It just says, hey, as you do to the Lord, the same way that you submit yourself to the Lord, that's the same way you submit yourself to your husband. It says, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Key word there is everything. He didn't say some things. He didn't say one or two things. He didn't say, hey, when I feel like it. He didn't say, hey, the sky is blue today. I'm like, I like blue skies. No, you fed me bacon and eggs. So I'm a, no. He said everything. That means all the time in everything that you do, no matter what's going on, whether you like it or not, it's in everything. Help me, somebody. So it requires cooperation. It requires working together, right? Two minds are better than one. So it doesn't mean you have to be quiet. It doesn't mean that you can't say anything. It doesn't mean that you don't have a voice, but there's a way that you speak to your husband. There's a way that you approach your husband. Amen. And you go to your husband with love. You go to your husband with care, and you work to find a win-win solution. So it's cooperation, it's working together. Working together works. Help me, somebody. You got to work together. So ladies, you were created to be a helper. A helper. A helper means you coming alongside. I mean, you coming alongside, right? You coming along. I didn't say you in front. A helper is not in front. And a helper is not behind. You right there alongside. Come on, Jesus. Come on. I know I'm preaching to somebody this morning. You are a helper. It didn't say that you are in front. You are not the leader. And you're definitely not behind. You are not the follower. You are a helper. It says in the scripture, you are a helper. It means you are right side alongside the husband through good and through bad, through sickness and through health, through whatever. Whatever comes your husband's way, whatever comes that way, you are there to help. Yeah. Not to talk bad about him, not to dog him out. We all sin and fall short of God. None of us are perfect. You're not perfect, but you got to come alongside and help and create ways to make things better. You're not there to diminish him or to downgrade him or to talk down to him. You're his helper. Amen. So if he's going down, you're going down with him because you're his helper. Amen. So it takes compromise. And I don't use the word compromise. It's the word is a win-win. You're looking for a win-win solution. It's not a compromise. Compromise means one person loses. A win-win solution means both of you all win. Right. So it means you don't have to be right all the time. I know this. I know you all women think y'all know more than men. I get it. I got a wife. I get it. They think they know more than men. I get it. Trust me. But you don't know. You're not right all the time. There's sometimes you are wrong. Amen. Come on, help. Amen. Come on, Jesus. Yeah. Come on now. Y'all know y'all wrong sometimes. And, hey, and when you're wrong, women, it's okay to say, my bad. I'm wrong on this one. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Hey, it's okay. That's what women got to find in their spirit is that I'm sorry spirit. Amen. You need to get rid of some of them other spirits and find the I'm sorry spirit and letting that come out your mouth. Come on. It's all about relationships. I'm just trying to help y'all in these relationships. Amen. Amen. So that's what the word says. That's what the word says. So let's talk about husbands. We talked about women. We talked about the wife. Let's talk about the husband. All right, here goes some good stuff. I see all the wives. You got the attentive ears now. You right there in front of the screen. You right there with me on this one. So the role of the husband. So we're gonna stay in Ephesians 5:25-33. So one thing I want you to note right away. We read Ephesians 5. It was only three verses, 22-24. Three verses. All women gotta do is just get them three verses, right? Well, man, I'm here to tell you, we're talking 25-33. I think that's nine. You got nine verses. So you know the Lord really got something to say to you because it took him nine verses to get it out. Yeah. I'm telling you. So that means your work is three times as much as what the woman had to do. So So get ready. Get ready. So this is what it says. It said, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with the water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands are to love their wives as their own bodies. We're getting to some good stuff now. Husbands are to love their wives as their own body. He who loves his wife loves himself. All right, here's the one I really like, verse 29. After all, no one hated their own body, but feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother. I said it again. He's going to leave your father and your mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. So it says, you know, the very first thing it says, men, we are created to love our wives as Christ loved the church. To love our wives as Christ loved the church. And you can't take that lightly. And that is not a sometime thing. That's not a sometime thing. Does Christ love the church sometimes?
Right.
Christ loves the church all the time. So you got to love your wife all the time. So it says love your wife. It didn't say anything in that scripture about being in love with your wife. It says love your wife. It didn't say anything about being in love with your wife. In love is a totally different thing. In love is a feeling. In love is an emotion. In love is a feeling. In love is an emotion. There's some days that my wife is in love with me. Glory to God. Sometimes my wife is not in love with me. Help me, Jesus, be a witness. Come on, man. Sometimes she's in love with me, and sometimes she's not. It's almost like that candy bar. Sometimes I feel like a nut. Sometimes you don't. So that's just how it is, right? And the same thing, vice versa. Sometimes I'm in love with my wife, and sometimes I'm not. But that's an emotion, and that's a feeling. But the Bible is not talking about an emotion or a feeling. The Bible is talking about love, and love is an action word. Love is an action word. It's not, hey, something's going on really nice today. She bought me a gift, or he bought me a gift, or he took me out to dinner, or... It's none of that. That's going to get you. That's an in love kind of thing. That's going to come and go. But that love is here to stay. That love is constant. That love is everlasting. That love is here to stay. And this is what it says in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, when it talks about love. Because I want you to be love. I don't want you to be in love. It's cool to be in love, and it's going to come and go. But the thing I really want you to get is love. What does it say? What does the word say about love? Because the word says nothing about in love. It does have something to say as it pertains to love. And it says in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, it says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless. That's that in love thing. I mean, that's going to come. It's useless, right? But love, it says it. If you didn't hear anything I said, listen to this last sentence. But love will last forever. Love lasts forever. Amen. 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 So it's being love. It's love, not in love. And it says, and when you read that, it's specifically saying Jesus was unselfish. He was unselfish. So men, we have to be unselfish, right? No more me and mine. You know, I like my theater room. I'm cool with that. But, and I used to call it me and mine until I just read the scripture just now. So it's no more me and mine. So whatever I get, my wife gets. Whatever the Lord blesses me with, he blessed her too.
Right.
Amen. So wherever I go, guess what? My wife goes. Whatever the Lord bestows upon me, whatever favor the Lord bestows upon me, his child, is also connected to my wife because we are one flesh.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So it's no more me and mine. No more me and mine. It's us and we. It's us and we. Amen. So the other thing that Jesus, he sacrificed for the church. He made a sacrifice for the church. So husbands, you got to sacrifice for your wife, right? There's some things that you may want to do, some things you may want to buy, some places you may want to go, but you got to make a sacrifice for your wife. She may have something else on her agenda, something else in her career, something else that she's, another goal that she's trying to accomplish that may supersede yours right now. Amen. So you got to make that sacrifice and say, hey, this is for my wife because I love my wife the same way Christ loved the church. Amen.
Amen.
So husbands, you got to make a sacrifice. And then, and the other thing, that Jesus died on the cross for the church. He died for the church. His blood cleansed the church.
Yes.
It's the blood of Jesus that cleansed the church.
Amen.
Amen. So that's what it says. He died on the cross for the church. So husbands, you got to die for your wife. You got to die for your family. Amen. Amen. That means you got to die to self. That means you, no more you, no more you. You got to die to self daily and live for Christ. Meaning, and if you're married, you got to live for your wife. You got to do things for your wife. You got to die. Whatever's eating at your flesh, whatever's holding you down, whatever thing you're battling, you gotta plead blood of Jesus over that and ask the Lord to remove that from your tongue, remove that taste from you so that you can die to self. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, and the other thing, man, I can't stress this enough. And it says through the word, it says in the scripture, through the word. So you got to read your Bible, man. If you want to be the head of your household, you got to be a God-fearing man. You just can't be out all night doing all kind of peculiar and strange things, having peculiar and strange relationships. No, if you want to be the head of your household, if you want a woman to submit to you as she does the Lord, then you got to be Christ-like in your ways.
Yeah.
Amen. You got to be Christ-like in the way you walk. You got to be Christ-like in the way you talk. You got to be Christ-like in the way you look. I'm here to tell you, if it walks like a dog, talk like a dog, and bark like a dog, it's a dog. Let's just call a dog a dog. Amen. But here, let me tell you, if you walk like a Christian, talk like a Christian,
Amen.
And act
Amen.
Like a Christian, you're a Christian.
Yes.
And you have deserved
Yes.
to be the head of your household.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. So you got to read your Bible. You got to pray over things. You got to meditate over your household. You need to go through your entire household and plead the blood of Jesus and anoint everybody in your household that they follow Jesus. Amen.
Right.
Amen. Don't be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So it says, love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. So whatever, again, I'll say it again, whatever I get, my wife gets.
Yeah.
Wherever I go, she goes. She's my equal. She's not in front of me and she's not behind me. She is right here. It says in the word that the woman came from Adam's rib. It didn't say it came from Adam's back.
Right.
It didn't say it came from Adam's chest. It came from Adam's rib. Amen. So you have to treat her as your equal. She's not your subordinate. Amen. It's not somebody you can tell what to do and they have to run and do it. Them days are over with. Those days are long gone. I mean, we got women that's high in academics. We got women that are high in intelligence. We have women that have goals, dreams, and aspirations. I mean, those days that went on back are long gone. Women are not to be barefoot and pregnant. They got things they want to do too. Amen. Amen. So you just got to treat each other with love. Treat your wife with love. With love, respect, and honor. Love, respect, and honor. So in every marriage, there will be some pain. I want you all to know it's not easy. There's two things that I always share with people. Marriage and ministry are the two hardest things that I've ever done. Ministry, what I'm doing now, ministering to people, is hard. It's tough. And marriage is equally hard and tough. Marriage and ministry are tough because they take a lot out of you and require a lot of your time. It's an investment that you're making in people. Amen. Amen. When so many times our flesh want to make an investment in us, but as being called into to Christ, the body of Christ, and also being married, you know, you have to invest in other people. It's not all about you anymore. So there's going to be pain. It's not going to be easy, but it will be rewarding. If you just stay in there, the Bible says, as for you, be strong and do not give up. Your work will be rewarded. As for you, be strong and do not give up. Your work will be rewarded. Amen. So in Genesis 2 and 23, it says this. And this is the pain that I'm talking about. It says, and Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. So just think about the pain. Of course, Adam was, quote unquote, sedated. But just think about the pain that you feel when you lose a part of your body. Say, you're, like in this case, your rib is removed. That's painful. Amen. That's painful. So pain is going to come along with it. Pain's going, it's not going to always be this primrose path. Everything is not going to always go according to plan. Sometimes you're going to have to make some adjustments on the fly. But here's the thing to do it. As long as you're making those adjustments on the fly with the Lord in mind, you ask the Lord for guidance. You ask the Lord to give you strength. You ask the Lord for clarity. As long as you're asking the Lord and the Holy Spirit to lead and guide you, then you're going to be okay. But if you go before yourself, if you take this thing on above, on your own and go about it your own way, it's going to lead to destruction. You're just allowing bad things to happen. You're allowing the devil to creep into your relationship and cause havoc. Amen. Amen. So it says the creation of woman was made out of rib of the side of Adam. Now, she was not made out of his head to rule over him. She wasn't made up here to rule over Adam. Amen. Amen. Nor was she made below Adam so that the man can trample on her. So man, you're not to trample on women. You're supposed to love, honor, and respect women. But out of his side, to be equal, she is your equal. This is a relationship. She is your equal. And under his arm to be protected. So husbands, we got to protect our family. We got to protect our wives. And near to his heart. And it's all about your heart. I always talk about your heart because that's very important. Whatever's in your heart is going to come out of your mouth. Amen. Whatever's in your heart is going to show up in your actions. If you got a bad heart, you're going to have bad words and bad actions. If you got a good heart, you have good words and good actions. Now, your intentions, you can have good intentions. It may not go according to where you want. But if you got a good heart, you're going to have good actions and good words. Amen. The Bible says that a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. And a good fruit and a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. Only a good tree can produce good fruit. That's talking about your heart. Amen. Help me somebody. Come on now. So when pain comes, when the pain comes, it's going to come. I'm telling you it's going to come. Trust me. I'm telling you it's going to come. This is my second marriage. And I'll be the first one to tell you, in my first marriage, I was a good father. I was a good father. I wasn't always a good husband. I was a good father, but I wasn't always a good husband. Glory to God. Glory to God. I wasn't. So I'm here to help you. I'm here to help somebody today. So when the pain, when pain comes, don't get caught up in your feelings. Don't get caught up in your feelings. This is not a feeling thing. You know, when you get caught up in your feelings and you start feeling some type of way and you start reacting some type of way, you start reading things out of context and reading things differently than the way they should, and you get on the phone with your girlfriend or your guy friend and they start filling your head with these things, you call your mother or your father. You shouldn't be talking to none of them anyway about your relationship as it pertains, not unless it's some kind of physical abuse or mental abuse, then you got to reach out to other folks. But generally speaking, you got to keep them out. And they start telling you this and telling you that. Girl, if that was my husband, I'd leave him. And she don't even have a husband. Ain't never had a husband. If that was my wife, I wouldn't tolerate that. I'd do this. And he doesn't even have a wife and ain't never had a wife. Amen. You know, your parents start getting all this noise coming from all over in your ear. So I'm here to tell you, you got to get rid of that. Amen. Get out of your feelings and don't do what you think, because it's not about what you think. You got to do what the Bible says. Pick up that Bible. Every answer you need to know as it pertains to your marriage, life and godliness is in the Bible. Amen. Amen. So, and I'll close with this. You got to remember, and you're dealing with relationships in your marriage. You're dealing with relationships in your marriage. It's your friend. Your wife or your husband is your friend. Your wife or your husband is your friend. And there's a certain way that friends talk to friends. There's a certain way that friends act with friends. I mean, I got friends, and I'm telling you right here and right now, me and my friends, we don't argue. Me and my friends don't cuss each other out. Me and my friends don't stab each other in the back. Me and my friends don't run and cry wolf. Me and my friends, we don't do any of those things. That's your friend. That is your friend. And here's a scripture I'm going to leave you with, and I'm done with this scripture. In Colossians 4 and 6, it says, you got to have these conversations, right? It says, let your conversations always be full of grace. Mm-hmm. How many of y'all know that God's grace is free and God's grace is undeserved? Mm-hmm. The same kind of grace that the Lord gave us is the same kind of grace we got to give our spouses. Amen.
Amen.
It says season with salt. It's seasoned with salt. Salt is a preservative. It's a preservative. You got to have salt in your words to preserve it. It actually is going to help you on what comes out of your mouth. You just don't want anything coming out of your mouth. So you got to preserve. You can't say everything you think. You can't say everything you feel. It's not about you. It's not about you. You can't try and put somebody in their place or I got a cake baked. No, you ain't got no cake baked for anybody. Amen. Amen. You got a cake baked for someone else. The Lord got a cake baked for you. Amen. That's what the Bible says. Amen. So it's seasoned with salt. So I mean, it's preservative. You got to preserve your marriage. You got to talk gently. You got to talk kind. It says so that you may know how to answer anyone. So that you can know how to answer someone. Amen. So if you're attacking someone, or someone's attacking you, then you got to have some calmness and resolve about yourself so that you can know how to answer, that you could always be a child of God. You can answer in the way that the Lord has raised you to be. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So that's all I have on marriages. This is important. Marriages are important. And again, I'll stress that outside from your faithfulness, outside from following Jesus Christ, outside of making a commitment to the Lord, the next biggest commitment you can make is to your marriage. Amen. And again, I'll say it's to your marriage. Some of us have children. Some of us have children. It's not to your children. Your children should never come before your wife. Let me stress that again. When you have children, if you don't have them now, or if you have children now, you can always course correct it. Your children should never, ever come before your wife. Amen.
Amen.
It's the Lord and then your wife. Part of your marriage. If you're married, it's that. In that order, your marriage is important. Your marriage is a high-level covenant between a man and a woman. Amen?
Amen.
So you got to be mindful of that. You got to be mindful. So I'll conclude and say, if this word spoke to you, I ask that you please share it. Please share it. Reach out to some of your friends that are either thinking about getting married or married right now. Reach out to your friends and share this word with them because it'll help them. It'll help them. We have to learn to be disciples of Christ. And we just can't keep everything to ourselves. We got to share with others. We got to extend that out to others. And we got to help them become better. Yeah. Amen. We got to encourage others. So if this word was encouraging to you, if you know someone that's either thinking about getting married or married now, share it with them. It's going to help them. It's going to bless them. Amen. Amen. And then also, I want you to know that the Lord loves you. He cares for you. He died on the cross for you. His blood lives. His blood reigns. The Lord Jesus loves you. Amen. Amen. And for those of you who don't know the Lord and have not experienced how much he loves you, I'm going to give you a chance right now to accept the Lord. I'm winning souls for Christ. Part of my job is to win souls for Christ. And I'm going to extend to you an opportunity right now to be saved by Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. To be saved, to fall into the family of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
So if you need to be saved right now, this word spoke to you and you're saying, hey, I need to be saved. I need to line up with the word of God. I need to make sure that I am in sync with what the Lord has me to be. I need to be a God-fearing woman, a God-fearing man. I want you to say this short prayer with me. Say this short prayer with me. Just repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you confessing as a sinner. I come believing Jesus died on the cross for my sins. I believe Jesus was raised from the dead and lives forevermore. I accept the free gift of salvation, and I accept you as my Savior in my heart so that I can have eternal life. And if you said that short prayer, you are now saved. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. You are now saved by the grace of God. We're going to cheer that on. You are a part of God's family. So here's what I want you to do. If you said that prayer with me, I want you to send us a email. Send us an email and let us know so that we can come alongside with you and walk with you through your new faith journey. You can email us at transformationcommunitychurch1@gmail.com. Again, it's transformationcommunitychurch1@gmail.com. Amen. So at this time, I'd like to open the doors of our church. My wife, Renee, is here. She's still my wife after the day. We're still together. We didn't bust up. We're still together. Hey, hallelujah. Glory to God. We're still here. We're still here. She's here with us. We have our leadership team here with us. We have Pastor Art that's here. We have Sister Rachel that's here. We have Brother Josh that's here. We have Elder Kim that's here. We're all here to welcome you. Amen. We're all here to welcome you with open arms and the love of Christ. So if you need prayer, please give us a call. You can reach us at 480-524-7080 or just send us an email at transformationcommunitychurch1@gmail.com. Amen. If you want to join our church, and I'm thankful that we're receiving new members each and every week. I'm grateful and thankful for what the Lord is doing here at Transformation Community Church. So if you'd love to join our church, I'd love to be your pastor. So just call us at 480-524-7080 or just email us at transformationcommunitychurch1@gmail.com. And lastly, if you would love to support our church financially, we accept prayers as well. But if you love to support our church financially, please send it Cash App. That's $TransformationAZ, $TransformationAZ. We also have Venmo. That's @TransformationAZ. That's @TransformationAZ. You can also send it via text. And that number is 844-893-3298. And just enter your dollar amount in the content there. And then we also have the old-fashioned way, which is in mail. And you'll see our address there on the screen. So I'll go through it one more time, just for those who didn't get it the first time. Cash App, $TransformationAZ. Venmo, @TransformationAZ. Text to give, 844-893-3298. And lastly, our address, which you'll see here shortly on the screen. Amen. Amen. If you missed any of those, like I said earlier, just feel free to go to our website, transformationaz.com, and you'll see all the multiple ways that you can give, and then also you can learn more about us. Amen and amen. So I thank you all for your time today. It's been an awesome series and an awesome sermon today, looking at marriages. I'm thankful that the Lord placed it on my heart to share with you. And I know that I was preaching to someone today. Amen and amen. So until next time, may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord shine his face upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Just know that I love you. Lady Renee loves you. All of us here at Transformation Community Church loves you. And just know that God loves you so much more. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.